So let me guess, you probably heard something along these lines about 7,000 different times.
Man, to get the win, you gotta get the click. Man, you gotta make better thumbnails to do good on YouTube.
So how do we do it? Well, that's exactly why I clicked this video, because I assume you just bought Affinity Photo or you've been using it for a while and you're trying to learn how to make thumbnails that look like this. Today, I'm going to be showing you my 5 different things I do to make my thumbnails pop on YouTube, so that way you can apply those right now to start having thumbnails that don't look like my intern Phillips.
Hey, my thumbnails look professional, bro.
Let's just get started. What's going on, guys? My name is Max and welcome back to another video. If this is your first time on my channel and you want to learn how to make awesome and successful YouTube content, make sure you subscribe right now so that way you don't miss any content. All right, so we're just going to jump right into it, and I'm going to assume that you have a basic understanding of how to use Affinity Photo. So the first thing we're going to be doing is we're going to actually be creating a new artboard, and we're going to be making this artboard 1280 by 720 with a 300 DPI. Once you got that sorted out, you're going to actually go ahead and go over to the left side and create a rectangle using the rectangle tool, and that rectangle is going to be obviously 1280 by 720 as well. So the first major thing you need to do when designing your thumbnails is figure out what type of background you want to use. In this case, we're not going to be using a picture, we're going to be using a colored background. More specifically, we're going to be using my favorite type of background, which is a gradient colored background. Now, a lot of people don't know that there's actually multiple different types of gradient backgrounds. More specifically, there's 3 that we particularly care about. Those 3 being linear, elliptical, and radial. Linear is your typical straight line gradient that you're going to see on most people's backgrounds. Basically just makes a line that goes straight across whatever image, and it just has multiple colors most times too. Elliptical and radial are pretty much the same thing. What happens is there's a color that you pick that goes in the middle of the image, and then what happens is it spreads out to the rest of the image in a wave circular format. The major difference between these two is that radial will actually preserve the outer color even if you move the slider in the middle all the way to the far left or the far right side. The cool thing about this is that there's no limitations on how many colors you can have on these things. I mean, you can sit there and add 40 different colors in, and you're gonna be able to do it. Overall, gradient borders are a good way to make your image stand out a little bit more, especially if you use multiple colors that are actually contrasting from whatever images that you add in as well. So now we're gonna switch gears and go away from the actual background of the image, and we're gonna focus in on the text if you wanna add text to the image. So the type of text that I use that has become a staple on all of my thumbnails pretty much has been this 3D style text. How you can do this is actually really simple. What you're gonna do is you're gonna go ahead and pick out the type of font you wanna use. I typically lean toward the impact font, which is my main font that I use. But for numbers and other things, I typically use the Fungus 1 font. So go ahead and pick out your font, type out what you want for your thumbnail text, and then you're gonna go ahead and make it whatever size you want. Just to be able to see it right now, we can actually adjust it and make it the correct size at the end. With the text selected, what you're gonna do is go over to the right side of the screen. You're gonna check the effects box and go ahead and add an outline to your text. What this is gonna do is gonna be able to add a little black outline around your text, and you're gonna make that somewhere between 3 to 5. This is the part where you get to decide which direction you want your text to go. What you're gonna do is you're gonna press and hold the control button, and then you're gonna left click and drag the text in whichever direction you want. Essentially what this is doing is it's creating a copy of your text. The main thing you wanna keep in mind here is that you don't want it to be too far off, because if you do, it's gonna create this weird jagged edge whenever you go to the next part. So just make sure this is slightly off, and what you're gonna do now is you're gonna start pressing control J to create additional copies, and they'll start going in this direction that we're talking about. There's really no number in terms of how many of these you make. Basically, the idea is the more that you make, the bigger the little black part of the 3D text is gonna be. So now, depending on how many you decided to make, you're gonna see a bunch of copies of your text on the right side of the screen. So go ahead over to the right side of the screen and select the bottommost text, and you're gonna press control and the right bracket option, and that's gonna send your original text to the top of the list. After that, what we're gonna do is we're gonna select the second text, which is our first copy, and then we're gonna go down to the bottommost text, and we're gonna press shift left click, which is gonna select everything, and then we're gonna press control G to group everything. So what you should be seeing is you should be seeing your original text separated from all the groups of your copy text. So now what you're gonna do is select the overall group for the copy text, and we're gonna go up to the color options, and we're gonna drag all of those color options to black and make the text overall black. So at this point, you should be seeing the same thing that I have on screen right now, and if you are, what you're gonna do is select your original text and your group text, and go ahead and press control G to group those together, so that way you can resize it easier, as well as do some other options that we're gonna talk about as well. So regardless of what background or text you decide to use, you can actually make these pop a little bit more using a few enhancement tricks. For example, with your text, we can take those same principles we talked about with your gradient and add that to your text, so that way your text pops a little bit more and has some different color. With that being said, me personally, I typically don't add gradients to any of my text, but the one thing I will do is I'll pick a part of my text and make it a different color. This just makes a little bit of a breakup in your text when people are reading it, so that way it doesn't look like one big blob of text. So if you decided to make this 3D text that we just talked about, you can actually go back and add an outline to it. Basically, what you're gonna do is you're gonna select the entire group as a whole, and you're gonna go over to the outline and you're gonna add a white outline to it, and this is gonna make it pop out of pretty much any background. Obviously, a lot of you are probably gonna wanna add yourself or add other images into your thumbnails, and you can actually add some really cool effects like glow effects or drop shadows to these images. These are actually really simple to add, and in the effects section on the right side with the image selected, what you're gonna do is you can add different things like glow effects from here, as well as different shadow effects. Typically, when I add photos of myself, I'll usually add a glow effect and a drop shadow to this, so I'll usually add the outer and the inner glow, and then I'll also add a drop shadow. To add the drop shadow, just go over and check the outer shadow box and set the offset off as far as you'd like, and you can also add some blur effects with the other options as well. So talking about different ways we can enhance our background, because obviously right now it's looking a little boring and bland even with the gradient color, we're gonna actually add a sunrise effect to this background. So to make this sunrise effect happen, what you're gonna do is go over to the left side of the screen, and you're gonna see where you had that rectangle tool option. We're gonna grab the cogwheel tool option instead. With this cogwheel tool selected, just go ahead and shift and left click and make this as big as you'd like. So you'll notice with the cogwheel selected, there's these little red dots all over the cogwheel. What we're gonna do is focus on that top left one. So go ahead and hold control and left click and drag this down to the center of the cogwheel, and this is gonna create that sunrise ray effect. So this is obviously way too bright and vibrant and strong. So what we wanna do is we're gonna go over to the opacity filter, and we're gonna drop that down to 50%. You should have an image that looks like this, and if you do, what you're gonna do is drag this down and actually add it just over your background, and this is gonna create a really dynamic effect. And if you want to adjust the size, just do the same thing, shift and left click and make it as big as you like. This is great for being able to highlight and accent certain parts of your image. Like if you're doing a product review, like I did this Elgato Wave thumbnail, it actually really highlights and adds a lot of pop to that image. Another one of my favorite things to do with thumbnails is to add arrows to my thumbnail. Now, I don't mean just adding these boring regular arrows. What we're going to do is we're going to add some dynamic arrows that bend a lot like this. To start making these arrows, go ahead over to the left side of the screen and grab the pen tool option. Once you have the pen tool selected, go back to your thumbnail and select two different points on the screen. Once you got your points selected, go up to the top of the screen. You're gonna click this box right here. Once in there, we're gonna go ahead and increase the width so that way you can start seeing your arrow appear. Once you have the width where you want, you're gonna go down to where it says end, and you're gonna pick from the different arrow options. So from the same screen, to add a little bit more of a dynamic to our arrow, we're gonna go down to the part where it says pressure. On the left side, we're gonna control, left click, and drag that far side all the way down. You should start seeing your arrow get a little bit skinnier on one side, and you can actually do the same thing on the right side if you'd like, but really, you don't really need to do that too much. Now that we're done with all that, we're gonna go ahead and start adding the curves to our arrow, and how we're gonna do that is by going back over to where the pen tool is, and we're gonna change that to the node tool. With the arrow and the node tool selected, you'll start seeing these little white boxes appear around your arrow. So what this is gonna be able to let you do is to be able to add some curves to your arrow. As an example, if you control left click in the middle of the arrow and drag it up or down, it's gonna make this curve happen right in the middle of the arrow. The cool thing about these arrows is you can do whatever you want. They can go in all sorts of different directions, have zigzags, all sorts of different things, but the main thing is that you want to start playing around with this node tool to be able to get the arrow you want.
That thumbnail's pretty cool, but mine's still better.
Did you seriously just dab? I mean, whatever. Now, if you found this video helpful, I'm pretty sure that you're gonna find the rest of my videos on thumbnails equally as helpful. Thank you guys so much, and we'll see you next time.
Scale of 1 to 10. How's the sound? An 11? Dude, I love this, man. An 11 out of 10! Alright, so we're gonna be using this microphone from now on. I'm getting rid of this microphone. So if you guys got like $50, I'll sell you my Wave microphone, because this microphone is way better.